that we had in Jakub Kapilevich today, who is, in my view, one of the most interesting people that I ever met. And he is a scientist. You know, there are, it's very tempting to say something. Yes, there are people who are outstanding and are able to solve extremely difficult and challenging problems posed by others. Yes, we know cases which make them great and famous. But Jakub Kapilevich is a person who can pose them, who is one of those who pose these problems. And he is so often so much ahead of his time. And I'm sure that, I mean, I'm looking very much forward to this talk. Sorry for that.
Okay, thank you very much. And actually, after such an introduction by Misha, I'm already afraid if my talk will be really meet all the characteristics posed by Misha. But in any way, thank you very much. But I don't agree too much with it's things what I will tell actually just physics, okay, and just that, just physics, okay. So it's okay, the microphone, yeah. Okay, good morning, and actually I will try to be in time. So let me just start. This is the title, and actually, as always, you will see the title will be just a small last part of the talk, and you will see why it's justified. And this is actually justified by necessary introduction and discussion of physics of graphite, which roughly 20 years ago. When the first time I just handled this piece of graphite and read the books, I realized that everything is solved. But after we start research on this one chemical element, allotropic form of carbon is called graphite, we realized that there's a lot of things interesting in also related to modern physics could be found out, and this is actually was our motivation. So as you see, practically any handbook of solid state physics start with the Bense crystallographical structure of graphite, this stack of honeycomb graphitic planes, and the most stable that is possesses the lowest free energy is so-called Bernal stacking. When you see one of the sublattices of graphene plane atom, for example, B, just will be projected on the center of hexagonal or other planes. And all the physics actually of graphite and the questions and still open questions are due to how strong interaction, how strong coupling, in spite of its, everybody agrees that this is some sort of van der Waals interaction, how it's strong. Because if we'll just forget of any coupling between the planes, what we have in bulk graphite sample, basically not infinite, but very large number of graphene planes stacked in this way, as I mentioned. But Physics of the graphite in this case is often people call this today multi-layer graphene, which is actually acceptable in the sense that all the physics of decouple or independent graphene planes, graphene planes is just one single plane of graphite, will be governed by linear spectrum of, as shown in here, there are two chi prime points in the brilliant zone. All the brilliant zone will be shrink to these two points. And you can describe by linear dispersion is differently from result of for most, let's say, most of main known semiconductors or metals with parabolic dispersion. In other words, the Schrödinger equation is it works, and we have quasi-particles which characterized by finite effective mass, which now just inverse of second derivative of energy on k vector. Okay. And but in graphite, in graphene, you see it's quite differently. And people realized many decades ago that Dirac type equation is more suitable to describe band structure and physical properties of such a system. That's why often people call this Dirac type electrons, in spite of Fermi velocity still 300 times less than light velocity, so it's not actually quantum electrodynamics, but you can really use similar to quantum electrodynamic equations to describe band structure. Actually, it was realized decades ago, but not only for graphite. Narrow band Halkigen semiconductors also was studied in 1980 in bismuth as well. In all these materials, the people realize that at least for some group of carriers, it's better to use the Dirac, or depends on the system, depends on the, for instance, if time reversible symmetry respected or not, whale type. Okay, so and this is actually was quite a long time, just a theoretical interest, in spite of. This not many people know. Graphene was extracted in 1962 in the group of Boehm in Germany, and there is publication on that. But of course, it was not go forward, and not was studied as in the last roughly 15 years, I guess. Okay. So what was actually main theoretical description in which led to different from graphene, let's say, understanding of physical properties of graphite? This is due to Slonczewski-Weiss-McClure model that they consider quite big transfer integral between the planes, and formation of the Fermi surface, as you see, as I already mentioned, in along c-axis. But in the case of graphite, you graphene, you have only chi and chi prime. But in this case, you have pockets of holes and electrons along c-axis. So you have the basically semi-metals with all the characteristics of massive carriers. And in plane, pardon me? It's roughly the same. There is some special thing at each point, and I will mention this later. Yeah, but actually, it's very, very small phase space. But actually, there is some speciality in each point, and I will tell about it. But roughly, if you consider, for instance, extremal cross section and all the quantum oscillation techniques to extract the effective mass, you get roughly the same. Okay. If you consider still, if you consider the charge transfer between the neighboring neighbors, or in other words, neighboring Hopping energy, it's much bigger than even McClure-Slanchevsky Weiss model. But what happened from experimental size, even from results of Herring and Wallace, by the way, I didn't start from the beginning, but Wallace actually was first who proposed the electronic band structure, but it was some modification done by Slanchevsky McClure. That's why it's more people more familiar with result of Slanchevsky Weiss McClure theory. But they performed the quantum oscillation measurements for graphite, and surprisingly, they found transfer integral much less than it was considered by McClure. So they already that times they conclude that this could be essentially two-dimensional. But always when we are talking three-dimensional, two-dimensional, we should specify what we mean when we say two-dimensional or three-dimensional or any dimensionality. But at least conclusion was that actually transfer integral or coupling between the planes could be actually much less than what McClure and Slanchevsky Weiss proposed. Actually, it was not calculated. Maybe in the end, I will tell you how they got this 0.4 electron volts. So, keeping this in mind, and I will simply not have the time to cover roughly 4 years of our studies before 2003. That time, actually, some very unusual behavior like field-induced metal insulator-like transition, appearance of some superconducting signal, localized superconductivity, even at temperature, elevated temperature, magnetism, which is now it's already practically known phenomena, it's intensively studied in different stacks of multi-layer graphenes. But my aim actually to show you some set of experimental results to show that theory of Slanchevsky and McClure is self-consistent within the parameters what they consider. But one thing is actually theoretical model, other thing is real physical object what we are studying. And this was our surprise in 2002-2003 when we saw measuring the Hall resistance behavior, which is known for two-dimensional system, is plateau in the Hall resistance, which is you can really tentatively associate to quantum Hall effect. But longitudinal resistance was not zero, and this is not surprising, and I will also comment about that. And only it was observed in system with huge anisotropy in the resistivity. If you measured resistivity along the C-axis and measured parallel to the planes, you get 100 times resistivity higher across the planes. This is huge anisotropy. There are people who are familiar with high TC, it's comparable to anisotropy of BISCU 2212, which is a quasi two-dimensional superconductor with similar ratio of the resistivity. And you see at low temperatures, plateau is more clear. There is even overshooting, which is also studied in two-dimensional semiconducting systems and is gone increasing temperature. Besides of the plateau itself, longitudinal resistance, in spite of it, just shows some minima and maxima. You see, it's basically present a cascade of insulator metal, insulator metal like transitions. Once again, resembling behavior between and within the plateau of in the quantum Hall regime, which is difficult to understand from other approximation or simply found for three-dimensional systems. So this is actually almost fingerprint of behavior of two-dimensional systems. And another way to check if it's really a quantum Hall plateau, and here I just show two HOPG highly oriented pyrolytic graphite, most well oriented graphite, and with anisotropy I already mentioned, and a single crystalline artificial or natural crystal which possesses anisotropy much less, you never see quantum Hall effect like features. And if you study transition plateau, the theory of the Pruiskian was proposed to characterize transition between quantum Hall plateau and two-dimensional system, you see it was really surprise. In spite of this exponent is not universal, but for two graphite sample we found plotting this derivative of the Hall resistance, the functional field, and the maxima, you see quite surprising correspondence what exponent was observed in various semiconducting system. And this is saturation seen after some years also in plateau-plateau transition, and saturation is some dissipative process, it's still unclear. Yeah? And this even this could be completely different seminar. Even I will not touch to this point, just to show you similarity. And once again, showing the similarity with graphene and arsenide gallium or graphite. When you compare the two-dimensional graphene and any semiconductor, you are not surprised. This is just the physics of semiconductors, two-dimensional system. But for graphite, and especially this was first time in 2003 measured, it's actually for us was very surprising. In what temperature you mean we measured? Lowest temperature we measured was 300 millikelvin. It's a reasonable temperature, comparable temperature. You see 400 millikelvin. Is actually the same. But the point that saturation start roughly in few Kelvin, 1 Kelvin. You see in graphene, its deviation start roughly 2-3 Kelvin, 4 Kelvin, yeah? And in our case, it start roughly in below 1 Kelvin. This is inverse temperature, yeah? This 1 Kelvin. Yeah, it is the same. Yeah, it's basically the same, yeah. Okay, but this is not universal. More or less universal behavior that saturation always happens because this dissipative process which what I'm saying that this is new regime, and I will be very scared even to start to talk about that. Okay, sure. Oh, okay, okay, but this is not was defined in this work, but actually later on we realized that it could be actually few layers involved in process. Yeah, in principle we can say. We can, and yeah. Yes. And actually, this was in context of ultra quantum limit. That's why I didn't include it. But I can tell you, this roughly roughly 6 kilo-ohm per square the resistance would be. Okay. But let me show you Stark eyes. In the Stark eyes, you will see immediately this. Okay. Okay. That time already, group in Manchester, Novoselov, Game, from one side, other side, Philip Kim, in USA, they start to peel graphene in multigraphene of thin graphite samples and measured. And you see, that time it was not yet obtained very thin graphitic plates. And for 8 micrometer thick, you see it's quite similar quantum hole like plateau with minimum in the resistance, what they published. And in a science paper, which is actually was not graphene, it was few layers graphite, also you see clearly integer quantum hole like effect with minimum in the resistance. And what Pasha asked, how the similarity, basically, your question with graphite and graphene. And the similarity, I think, quite good. Yeah, okay. So what's plotted here is quantum Hall effect in graphite in 2003, what that paper what I mentioned. And the result for the, this is a seminal paper by Novoselov with co-authors for a few layer graphite. That time they didn't know how many layers, but later on it was, I guess, estimated two or four layers. And you see, behavior is actually similar. Okay, so you can easily to see already the resistance and how many layers. Basically, a few layers that decouple from others. This you can actually to conclude. Yeah. But that time it's even not discussed. But normally, you know, the width of plateau is basically the disorder. No. In this case, they just make as you see as a function of a magnetic field, and it was not gating at that time. Yeah. No. Yes. The title of the paper is of course it was not the main result, but important for us the result is to compare the quantum Hall effect. Okay. Yeah, and yes, yeah. So the similarity is completely clear. But at that, of course, in that time it was not even discussion of Dirac type or massive type quantum Hall effect. Later on, what we have done with Igor Lukinchuk, he make an extremely good proposed method to separate using the phase analysis spectrum with massive or linear spectrum, and it also was possible to apply to analyze quantum Hall behavior, and you can see a comparison of bilayer graphene and our graphite results are quite good. Of course, carrier density is big enough in graphite, and we cannot go to the new to very close to zero Landau level, and we can only just guess what happened after that. But so in this case, we cannot conclude that this is really graphite can be considered as a composition of of bilayers, but at least it's just normal massive quantum Hall effect. Yes. Yes. Oh, no, 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 sorry. Massive party, massive, where is written massive? It's not written here. Massive means parabolic dispersion. Massive particles. Or massless. Okay. But this what I'm saying. This quantum Hall effect either really could my implies that graphite is disintegrated in bilayers, or is just some sort of two-dimensional entities with massive parabolic dispersion. Exactly. But it's better massless because Dirac could be also massive, yes, if the gap open. Okay. So, yeah. No, it's not why. Okay, but actually we done, this is bypassing. We have done some results in Campinas. The group Eduardo Granado, he was able the first time measured electronic Raman in graphite. And you see this transition corresponds transition between Landau levels, okay? And if you make the Landau plot, you just realize that it's much better go to dispersion expected for bilayer graphene than just for parabolic dispersion. So this results in some sense corroborate possibility of graphite be considered as a stack of bilayers. And another argument in favor of two-dimensionality or quasi-two-dimensionality of graphite is a theoretical paper. That time, Andrei Bernevik, so I guess just this actually my interference, okay. So he just started to work with graphite, and after that he moved to the topological insulator and so on, making impressive works on that. Yeah, and that time they just were interested to see what one expect from quantum Hall effect observation. Yeah, from thinking on the possibility of quantum Hall effect in graphite, and they essentially were based on Slonczewski Weiss model. Even they consider a coupling between the planes not so big as Slonczewski Weiss, and their result is the only one plateau is possible at very high magnetic fields, which is never have been observed, which has been observed in any graphitic system. Only, as I show you, there are plenty experimental results with stark ice-like dependence of quantum Hall plateau in graphite, and never was observed just one plateau is Slonczewski Weiss model suggests. And this is easily to understand, yeah, because what they need. They need go to lowest Landau level, in 20 Tesla, you have already gap big enough to overcome the coupling between the planes. So you essentially effectively go to two-dimensionality. This is basically, physically, the results. Okay. Coulomb interaction, but in, till now I didn't say anything on the Coulomb interaction. Yeah, but it once again depends on many parameters: the carrier density and the magnetic field itself. Yeah. But yeah, I cannot tell you definitely. I think it will be comparable. It will. I don't see parameter which immediately me tell that should be colon bigger or smaller. I don't see this. We published this PRL in 2009, but today I will not even touch this because it will be too much. No, because fractional quantum Hall effect was also observed in graphene, so it's not dance. But I would say really that I don't see the parameter which could be crucial for increasing or decreasing. Actually, the charge transfer between the planes naively you would expect that it should reduce the Coulomb interaction within the planes. The charge transfer between the planes should reduce the Coulomb interaction within the planes. Yeah, but it seems it's not happen. Yeah. But what's the parameter which will govern in quantum limit? The magnetic length. Yeah, magnetic length is just in the denominator, so and the dielectric constant. So what else? I mean, internal distance. Yeah. But it's the same. For one graphene, there is no internal distance. Yeah. Oh yeah, compared to not typical, but it's still much bigger. Yeah, much bigger. Yeah, the 25 nanometers divided by root square of the b. So the quantum limit, let's say 10, so 25 angstrom, several planes. Physical assumption Slonczewski-McClure model. You have this three-dimensional semi-metal. And you need high magnetic field, but still you have the weak coupling between the planes. So you have the Landau distance between Landau levels big enough compared to interlayer coupling. In this case, you effectively go to two-dimensionality. This is actually what Bernevik say. But it's never what I'm telling you, that it's never observed experimentally. Okay, and actually, this I will not make too many comments about this paper, but it's just a couple of months paper from Manchester group. Now it's, you see, title which say a lot of things, and already just confirming quantum Hall effect in graphite. This is really graphite in spite of the fields. You can see up to 100 nanometers, so it's infinite number of graphene planes. So just to illustrate newly discovered quantum Hall effect in graphite, and just supporting what I said before. This integer quantum Hall effect, but you see, they make exactly gating and carry density huge, 10 to 12. And in graphite, it's good graphite, you have at least order of magnitude less. So quantum limit, you get in graphite 5 Tesla, 5, 6 Tesla. You already an ultra quantum limit. Layer parity, day, and what they said that depends of the even or odd number of layers, quantization will be different. So in spite of the huge amount of layers, they feel a parity effect in this sense. Number of layers is not they claim that they can distinguish between 99 and 100. And they got different result for difference is what you expect exactly the plateau for No, 100 nanometers, so this 1,000, so you have 300 layers. 300 layers. Yeah, it's huge. Yeah, so I that's what I'm saying. I would not like to discuss the work of others, but only just as a I find that this good confirmation. There is some a model for to justify dimensional reduction, so on. But just after all, it's quantum Hall effect in bulk graphite. Okay, but now the question, if it's really two-dimensionality we can accept in some sense, the question immediately happened, can we see some signature, some remnants of Dirac spectrum? Yeah, it's just naturally, okay? Or it's something different. If we see some signature of Dirac, we can really build up all the physics and study all the physics in graphite, which was, by the way, so he proposed by Igor myself and many years ago for graphite. Okay, so this is what I will now show how to detect Dirac electron. This is could be quantum Hall effect, quantum oscillation, ARPIS, angle resolved photoemission spectroscopy experiments. You can see topology, just dispersion shape, and more, this is exactly what last part of my talk. And this is graphene error, people call, but I don't know really when it's it start, because if starting from obtaining of graphene, this already 5 decades, okay? But we are living in graphene era from point of view of studying, and in from this sense, it's really dates to 2005. So we have 15 years graphene era. So that's why what I'm saying that when it's before, this means it's before more than 15 years from now. Okay. I will show this paper. I will show this paper. And actually, he had experience already on that. Starting from working in bismuth. Okay, so and this is exactly what regarding the observation, you can study oscillation and analyzing the phase of oscillation. This is exactly actually original method was proposed by Igor Lukinchuk, but what people traditionally just making Landau plot, you can also distinguish between parabolic and massless linear spectrum when this phase appearance in the case of linear spectrum and is zero in the case of parabolic spectrum. So this is one of the way to detect Dirac type spectrum, or you measured star size half integer quantum Hall effect when it's also known result. Actually it even I guess in electrodynamics, in Landau book, it's already mentioned this results of in quantum electrodynamics on the half integer quantum Hall effect for Dirac fermions. So this is result of just condensed matter realization of this behavior of relativistic type quasi particles. And this is result to Nobel Prize. But this I several times I mentioned, this is exactly what essentially what Igor work with experimental results by us and what we published in 2004, two group of carriers. This is not surprising, this is known already for many, many times. But what was surprising that high frequency, which carries, which you would expect higher, larger cross section of Fermi's surface follow Dirac type linear dispersion of the carriers. Once again, you can more to visualize better Landau plot, I guess. This results experimental from 2003, and also in 2006 with Igor we just make this plot. You see, it's clearly you have massive, this Pasha, this what exactly massive, yeah? What I say, parabolic group of carriers in Dirac quasi 2D. Okay, this is complete analysis of quantum oscillations. Once again, I repeat this. Mainly this was Igor contribution, a very original approach. Okay, so this is done. This is the same samples, but you have the, you can separate contribution from two group carriers, and you can conclude on the what people call Berry phase, but the Berry phase maybe it's not necessary to tell you, it's just phase shift. Okay. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. The, you just made the Fourier analysis of oscillation. You got two frequencies. Yeah, and you analyze. Exactly. Two group of carriers. Dima. Yeah. Yeah. No, but shifted by the same half phase. Yeah. But they are not simple non-chiral carriers. No, but this is what I'm saying. I agree with you, but this is not shown this. It's just non-chiral. Non-chiral, exactly. I know, this is a very good point. Yeah, exactly. But you think it's helpful? Dirac type, and another group is still massive. What Dima made the correct comments is non-chiral. Okay, so it's important more experimental evidence for two group with different topology of spectrum. And this once again, what we in this, the same paper in 2006, we just make a comparison with the quantum Hall effect measured in the same sample, making this phase separation analysis of two group contribution that you see quite reasonable considering that we are talking on the bulk graphite. This is red line. This experimental data obtained for bulk graphite with gamma zero corresponding Dirac type dispersion. So what we can conclude actually is that we have two group of carriers in quasi two dimensional system is graphite, the consistence of weakly coupled graphene planes, and somehow some planes and huge amounts, I will comment about, on that right now, Dirac type, almost decoupled, which shows that Dirac type behavior. Actually, see, I would like to mention some very nice interlayer tunneling spectroscopy data by now late Yura-Latyshev. So they perfectly observe root square dependence expected for Dirac fermions. This I just make bypassing mention this result, and this is bulk measurements, okay, supporting what I would say from measurements of quantum oscillation of susceptibility, magnetic susceptibility, resistance, and Nernst effect. And actually, ARPIS is also interesting and instructive. All the experiment mainly, of course, was done by Alexandra Lanzar group. She called me that time and said that, that Yakov, do you want to contribute in this? I say, okay, let's do it. We just analyzed all this stuff. And even I also agree that this is, could be considered the first direct observation of Dirac fermion in bulk graphite in spite of quantum oscillation data, probably even more instructive from what sense? In the sense that the ARPIS measurements, they are just a study angle dependence within the plane of the Brillouin zone, you see? So what happened exactly, what we are interested along the HKH or H1K H prime, we don't know. This is essentially based on a theoretical model which you use to recover or construct the band structure. But what is important, at least around the H point, is really linear type dispersion. And K point is massive quasi-particles. Yeah, this is holes because you should extrapolate this above. Okay, so. Highly oriented paralytic graph. Compared to? With graphene? You cannot compare because there is no H point in graphene. Yeah. Okay. But what is the problem? I'm just trying to tell you what's the problem with Slonczewski Weiss. Slonczewski Weiss model is nice if it's really was a real object with such a huge interaction. But what's happened is that it's not the case. First of all, this Dirac point at H point, which was known for decades from Mildred Dresselhaus, she published with her husband many years ago already some hints, even some good evidence, experimental, that Dirac fermions should be located at exactly at H point. But what's important in Shubnikov, Degasov, Van Alphen measurements that it cannot be visible because what we are in quantum oscillation measurements important is extremal cross section. You see, it's far away, and this is just occupied extremely small phase volume of the Brillouin zone. It should be invisible, and the peaks. What I'm showing you, they are comparable in intensity. Also the high frequency for Dirac fermions would imply that cross-section of holes should be bigger if we relate with the holes than the electrons, which also contradict to the model. But at least to get all the totality of the results, we should assume that coupling between the planes should be much smaller than what is expected for Slonczewski with McClure model. Okay, so and this is what Mauro showing, I guess, wanted to mention right now. Abrikosov in 1999, he was trying to explain various results of linear magnet resistance. At that time, I guess, silver halogenides. Actually, he came back to his work on bismuth for 30-40 years before, when he showed a possibility on the linear magnetic resistance in ultra-quantum limit in bismuth. Okay, but in this case, he's assumed linear dispersion, and you see already in 10 tesla, let's say, you have huge distance between Landau levels, so you really can get, and also carrier density is small in that samples, and he suggests that you can really get quantum limit at high temperature and also at very low low magnetic fields. And he used also for graphite model, you see, assuming that still we have Dirac type dependence of energy of the magnetic field root square, assuming that the small hopping between graphene layers. Okay, but how small, that's what I already tell you, and probably it should be at least two orders of magnitude less than McClure-Slonczewski model suggests. And now it's already almost routine. Yeah, everybody report graphene layers in bulk graphite. You can read with, for instance, this result. This result from from Philip group, yeah, actually, at that time, Aaron Pinchuk, I guess his group was coordinate this experiment. And you see what's written. This is very important. Yeah, they study magnetophonon resonance in graphite. Yeah, he finds that the property superior single layer graphene Dirac fermions for graphene. You see. They propose some possibilities that some in maybe one or other reason for decoupling. But what to get this independent graphene layers? But it seems that this is general property in not only on defects. And actually, I come in, I know that I'm already running out of time. But rather quickly, because it's more outlook and concluding some sort of remarks, but important. Negative magnetic distance, it's quite possible. I will tell you what is that in how it can be additional support Dirac, or even possibly some indication for fermions resulting from effect of magnetic field. Yeah, so if it's some theories are correct, and Dirac point can be just splitted on two whale points due to time reversal symmetry breaking, is one of the possibility. But let me just quickly remind you that there is quasi two dimensional Dirac type conductor. It was observed some part of positive and after that negative magnetic resistance in ultra-quantum limit. This is Tajima theory in empirical, now empirical, the exact form of dependence of out-of-plane resistance as a function of magnetic field. Negative magnetic resistance is a signature of Dirac fermions because you have just simply increase the density of states and the Dirac points, which increase conductivity across the plane. This is basic idea of the theory. Initially, our results done up to 9 Tesla show really such a behavior. You can quite good fit experimental results, but only 9 Tesla, this is not enough. After that, we went to high field magnetic laboratory. This was in Toulouse done, and you see we measured up to 60 Tesla. This is up to 55 Tesla show the results. And we saw negative magnetic resistance, interlayer negative magnetic resistance up to 300 Kelvin. This is uptone, it's so-called high resistance state resistance. It's another half century puzzle. Graphite, I will not even touch. Once if somebody interested, I can talk about this in details. So now let me just show you all the curves. I can make the some sort of color plot in reduced scale, all the temperature scale nicely. This is already signature of this high resistance states, which I will not tell you what's that, because I am not interested in this particular feature. And this is actually in-plane resistance, which doesn't show negative resistance and down to very thin samples. But this is dashed line is a result of the theory of interlayer tunneling of Dirac fermions, which is quite good. Okay, I think I will skip this just to not be late to coffee break. So let's skip it. But what I would like to say is that negative magnetic resistance now is largely discussed in context of Adler-Bell-Jacquard type chiral anomaly in whale semi-metals. And this is very hot point. But what I want to just show you, this is nice work by Kikugawa with collaborators. It's just quasi two-dimensional layered metal. And they got the same expected for ultra-quantum limit for this chiral anomaly model, negative magnetic resistance, in other words, high conductivity between two whale points. Okay, actually, this is magnetic length, means that you have the 1 over H sigma, and the resistivity will be sigma proportional magnetic field or resistivity inverse proportional to magnetic field. Perfect. So what they say, okay, we don't know, but what's important, they say that we realize that this negative magnetic resistance vanishes when the field is tilted and reach some of these Yamagi angles, when you lose coherence in a quasi-particle tunneling across the planes. So, and after that, they say again words that this could be some interesting way to see if it's again chiral anomaly, even works apparently not whale metals. This is just normal quasi two-dimensional metal. It's not with no Dirac or whale features. No, this is exactly what the point. So actually what we check, and this is I think I would like to I couldn't resist and to show you this. For graphite, in some sense, it could tell us one more on the quasi-two-dimensionality and also maybe shed light on origin of a huge negative magnetic resistance in ultra-quantum limit. You see, if I rotate magnetic field away from the C-axis, in other words, within the more close to planes, I just kill this negative magnetic resistance. This is plot just for the same perpendicular component of the magnetic field, and you see the negative magnetic resistance just disappear when magnetic field component increases parallel In other words, magnetic field just apply more and more intense along the planes, and it kill this negative magnetic resistance. This you can visualize as what we suggest that possible magnetic field induce interlayer decoupling. Actually, this was already seen in organic metals by a Chaikin group many years ago. And the theory by Strong, Clark, and Anderson consider exactly this, that magnetic field parallel to the, it's better to say perpendicular to the tunneling direction, it can really essentially reduce transfer integral or coupling between the planes. And this, it seems, corroborate with such scenario. Okay. So this basically concluding remark on this last part that I did not say, but in concluding remarks is written, that in principle negative magnetic resistance, interlayer resistance is consistent again with Dirac type quasi-particles and also imply at least this is the sensitivity of electric field component and magnetic field angle is sensitive negative resistance to angle between them is would be consistent also with possible appearance of whale nodes and once again the chiral anomaly in principle is consistent at least. First glance is consistent with such a approximation. But irrespective of the chiral anomaly or model of Dirac tunneling between the lowest Landau level of Dirac points, irrespective of that, one should perhaps more close look on negative magnetic resistance in conventional metals. And it seems for quasi-two-dimensional metals, at least two results, well, I mentioned the result on this layered metal. And now for graphite, we see that the cogent quasi-one one-dimensional electron transport is essential, it seems, for negative magnetic resistance appearance. And why quasi-one-dimensional? Just remember, increasing magnetic field higher than quantum limit when the magnetic field is high enough to just to pull all the carriers in the lowest Landau level. What's not quantized, only quasi direction, and you have the quasi one-dimensional transport. And it seems this is, of course, the density state increases, and you can already say, okay, maybe this is enough already for negative magnetic resistance, but actually this is not enough. One should show this, that it could be enhanced conductivity. But at least it is a good possibility. The end. Okay. Thank you. Whale point. Well, I just